brown girls in the ring, and brown boys too. Crisp, clean shirts and pleated skirts, khaki shorts and polished shoes. We'd laugh and we'd joke, playing the fool, as we made our way to tin roof schools, carefree and happy-go-lucky. We were so naive, thought this is how our lives would always be. Jumping rope, elastic, hopscotch and jacks. We were climbing trees to catch a breeze. We'd bathe in the rain and run barefoot, look for a shady spot when the sun was hot, hot, hot. Eating sugar cake, tamarind ball, and tulum, sucking on a sour plum. We used to love to pelt green mango to make chow, and shell pigeon peas for granny to stew and make palau. Aloo pie, roti and doubles, on our way home to catch a film at the Roxy. Shopping on Frederick Street, bake frying and coconut ice cream churning. Car pack up and we head into Chaguanas, or even better, Maracas. We couldn't wait for the weekend to come. We would run along sandy beaches, lined by the Caribbean Sea. This idyllic life, we thought, would last forever. But now that sublime childhood is a sweet memory of TNT, an ideal. It is precious. It is a history that has shaped me.
Getting your words out to in the air in a way rather than specific people that were physically present.
We've had to learn to adjust.
Yeah.
So when I first started doing poetry, I went along to quite a few of those, you know, performances that happen in, you know, pubs and bars and, you know, open mics and that sort of thing. Yeah. So I was used to an audience, but I think lockdown has changed everything.
Yeah.
And we do things really differently. And there was something quite serene and calming, actually.
Yeah.
And also, because I was standing just a short distance from where I live, it's a very familiar space.
Yes.
And it's actually a very nice backdrop.
Yeah, it's
St.
a beautiful.
John's Church is, and that hill. And yeah. And it's a bit, there's a little bit of an irony, because when I first came to England in 1977, I lived in Eccleston Square with my
yes.
stepfather and my mother before we bought a house. And so we would go to Holland Park like every day, because my cousins, the only family we had, lived in Holland Park on Holland Park Avenue. And we would visit regularly and we'd be around the area. So
yeah.
it was the irony of talking, using words in a poem that were really about my childhood that I lost and left behind when I came to England.
Mm-hmm.
And I was actually in a space a few yards from where I was when I came to England.
Yeah, so many deep messages in that.
Mm.
When you write a poem, where does it come from within you?
That I'm not entirely sure. I think the world around me, it's mm. shaped by what I see, what I experience, what I feel,
mm.
what I've been, what I am.
Yes.
I mean, I try not to always write things that are triggered immediately by what's happened. Because in a way, always being reactionary, I'm not sure if that's the way to go. I kind of like to stop and breathe and think and see how things shape up. But I know the poem, one of the poems that I did in
yes.
this time of crisis
yes.
was very much about what was going on around me. But it wasn't written immediately when this all happened. It was actually a couple of months afterwards. When I was like reflecting on how people were reacting and the kind of, you know, I talk about psychological messages and, you know, all the almost the dystopian way that people were talking about things and the confusion. But again, there was a little bit of space in that.
How does it start off? Is it a word or a sentence, or how is it crafted? Is it, do you do it in your mind, or is it through the pen?
It's not through the pen.
Yeah.
I'm dyslexic.
Yeah.
And I started writing poetry very late in life. I was in my 40s. A lot of the poets and the spoken word artists that I know, they were children. They were like 11, 12, 13. You know, I was in my 40s, so I was a late starter. I always was slightly apprehensive about writing because of the dyslexia and my handwriting not being that great. But with the advent of technology and the iPad, I had an iPad mini and I really started writing on that.
Yes.
Because the tablet was just a perfect size to carry around, and I'd see something and I'd make a note. Or I'd hear something and I'd make a note.
Yeah.
Or I'd think something. And I think there is no one way. It sometimes it comes in waves, and I can literally sit and just write a poem. Other times, I craft a poem to fit a particular thing. So I'm writing a piece at the moment for a young group, a group of young people who are doing something for Black History Month.
Right.
And it's going to be performed in a Crown Court, in Blackfriars Crown Court. It's no longer a court. But in the 80s, I was a paralegal in the 80s and the early 90s. So, yeah, so I spent a lot of time in courts, getting people out of police stations, going to prisons, to take instructions for the solicitors and stuff that I worked for. So I have a background, and I studied law. That was my first thing, and I decided not to go. So this is being crafted by my experiences as a paralegal, my experiences as an anti-apartheid protester dealing with injustice.
Yeah.
As a person of African heritage and dealing with this notion of what is justice and racism and equality, the kind of myth of equity, and also what I learned in my 3 years doing an LLB.
Yes.
So it's kind of being very much a crafted piece, whereas other pieces just happen because they just come with the mood.
Within one flow.
Yeah, sometimes it's interesting.
I mean, I was quite impressed when you said, you know, that you have dyslexia and that you at 40 had the courage to, it does take courage to reconnect with yourself and say, well, I'm going to be, I am a poet and I'm going to express that part of me. Is there a kind of decisive moment, or was it an evolution that took you there?
I think it was a time in my life. So we go through changes in life. And as a woman, being in my 40s, you know, my daughters were now coming of age. They're now in their 20s, so they were sort of like late teens. Finally, I was kind of free. I often talk to people about the 90s, and I say sort of when at 94 and 95, I was having children.
Yeah, it was a blur.
I didn't know what was going on.
Yeah.
Like people are like, oh, so and so happened. I was like, really?
Yeah.
You know, I was going through baby brain. I was like, you know, and constantly, I have 20 months between my daughters. So it was like literally two in nappies. And so I spent like hectic time in my late 20s, early 30s.
Yeah.
Then it was all the school run and the getting them to this and they're doing that. And, and it was constantly always about my daughters.
Yeah.
It was never about me.
Yes.
I had locks for many years, and I remember the first time when I first had locks, they were so well groomed.
Yeah.
I had to take time and look after my hair and wash it. And then when I had my daughters, I literally had locks that were like sticking up hair and like no time to look after myself. So I think that my life was very much shaped in my late 20s and 30s by being a mother.
Yeah.
So suddenly in my early 40s, I was suddenly starting to be free. They didn't need to be picked up from school every day. They were doing their own things. They would, you know, I was divorced. That was another thing. So now, you know, they would go and stay with their father as well. Suddenly I'd be like free.
So that was
like,
a good thing.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, everything is yin and yang.
Pros and cons. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And so I think that was what it was. It was like a coming out or coming of age. And also I started
without the
menopause,
guilt, you know,
in my 40s, which I think is quite young. And that is another thing. There was another thing about being freed.
Really?
Yeah. So
you felt that.
Yeah,
how interesting. Because some people would see that period as a kind of going down period, but for you it was a kind of coming out.
Oh, I was looking really good then.
Yeah.
I was
liberated. You don't have to go through the monthly.
Yeah, exactly. So there was a whole change in my lifestyle and what I was doing. And I also had more freedom not to be, because, you know, for quite a while I was in a job full time, like running charities, project manager of this, and I was doing it because I needed the money to make sure my daughters had a quality of life.
Of course.
But suddenly it was like, well, I can be freelance. I don't need to earn as much money because actually they are more independent. There's things that I don't need to give them in the same way.
Yeah. Wow, that's beautiful. I can identify to that fully because I remember when I went through that period, I remember thinking, all of a sudden I had an idea and I thought to myself, oh my God, the last time I had an idea was about years ago. And so I think it's beautiful that you have that resurgence and your poetry is very based in reality, you know, and the reality of your personal experience, but also the experience around you. And I think it's about you, but it's also about enabling. I've noticed that. It's about enabling and community, because you're very much involved in the community. Is that a motivation for you? Does that affect you emotionally and what you strive towards accomplishing? Does it have to have a meaning to you, or is it more, you know, spoken word art, or has it to have a specific meaning?
I always say that my poetry is advocacy.
Advocacy, yeah.
Because I'm an advocate. That is really, you know, I was an advocate when I was an anti-apartheid protester on the streets. Yeah. I was an advocate when I was in police stations trying to get somebody out of custody. I was an advocate when I ran an advocacy project for looked after children. And I ran a charity in this borough for older people and people with learning disabilities. Or you know, disabled people. People with mental health issues. Yeah. I've worked in advocacy, and so I've advocated for those who don't have a voice.
Yes,
I'm a trainer. I do empowerment training and communication skills, mainly for women whose first language is not English.
Yeah.
So it's all about ensuring the voice of the voiceless.
Yes.
So I think that very much has an influence on the poetry that I write.
Yeah.
It is, there's an element of I'm advocating for something.
Yes.
Though there are things where I've kind of just mused on something and they may not have a deep message, but generally speaking, my bigger pieces and the pieces that have really kind of grounded me have been very much in that kind of.
And how, what do you feel is the position in our society of the spoken word? Like, what is the power of words? You know, there's that disparity between what is truth, what is not truth, what is, you know, written word, the spoken word. What is the place of words within our society at the moment?
Words frame narrative.
Yeah.
They shape our society. Ultimately, they can determine power dynamics. They can maintain power dynamics, and they can also strip them away.
Yes.
They are truth, and they're also deception.
Yes,
and
exactly.
Yeah. So we this whole thing now in the States with this fake news.
Exactly.
You know,
what is
exactly?
Yeah.
And for me, the other thing about language is the pliability. I think of it like Play-Doh. I think we should be able to play with it. It should be flexible. When I think about how we English was spoken in, you know, I don't know, Chaucer.
Mm.
We don't speak like that anymore.
Yes.
In Shakespearean times, we don't. If someone came and sat in this room and spoke in the way that Chaucer is written, you know, the Canterbury Tales, we wouldn't understand most of what was saying, what said, or what they were saying. It's like I've looked at when I was actually in Denmark years ago, and I saw some subtitles, and I noticed how similar Danish is to Old English. So language changes. It's a trajectory. And now we live in a time where people speak English in different ways. I come from a culture and a country where we had English imposed on us because we were colonized, my people were enslaved, and our languages were lost, the African languages we once spoke. And we spoke Trinidadian English.
Yes.
People call it patois or Creole. I'm not sure whether those are correct. They're perhaps diminutive. What we should be saying is that's claiming that kind of language. The language changes. So I come from a place where we speak English, where we put our pronunciation is different. We put stress on different syllables.
Yes.
But it's still English.
Yeah.
I think other people do that. If you look at like Italian and Spanish and Portuguese and French, they are derivatives of Latin.
Yes.
Portuguese used to be called Pig Latin or Dirty Latin.
Pig Latin, really? Is that where it came from?
Oh, Dirty
crazy.
Latin. No, Dirty Latin.
Really?
And how interesting. There's this whole idea, again, you know, why are some languages called languages and some called dialects?
Yes. Who chooses what
exactly,
that is? Who decides?
So there's a whole thing about power.
Yeah, power. And that's where history, they say history is his story. It's always a point of view of someone.
That's why we talk about
her story. Because
you're
story. That's why I bring that up. Exactly. Yeah. I think it's really interesting what you say about the sound of languages. because I'm lucky enough to speak six of them, and I know that I feel very different as a person when I speak French to Spanish to Arabic. All these different, the different side of your personality comes out. Do you find that you feel different when you speak, you know, from back home, or when you're speaking like British English? All of these, does that bring out a different side of you emotionally?
See, for me, I feel like there's a part of me that was robbed and shaped by the requirement to fit into a particular mold. So when I came here at the age of 11, I had a Trinidad accent, but I was sent to public school, and they said to my mother, basically, she needs to go to elocution lessons. So I was there for a couple of years, and I went to elocution lessons. So I left there speaking very differently to when I arrived. And then I then went to a state school, and where, then I was mocked and you know, I suppose bullied to a certain extent. We didn't use that term because my accent didn't fit with my face.
Really?
Because most of the children there are from working class backgrounds, and people that look like me weren't privileged and didn't sound sort of, you know, plummy. And so then I had to try and find a space that I fitted. And I remember trying to practice, like, watch your mate to try and sound like them, because they were being teased. And then over the years, I became kind of me. So I'm neither like sort of plummy, I'm neither like working class, and I'm I still pronounce some words. I find it difficult because I'm actually a Trinidadian still.
Yeah.
So I don't quite fit anywhere in that sense of you know, where. And when I think about like my daughters, I always try to say to them, look, you have to understand register. You have to be able to speak in a particular way to be able to get what you want, because this is a very classist society as well.
Yes.
And it's also quite a racist society.
And people judge you based on how you
exactly, how you look, how you speak.
How you speak, yeah.
And so you have to be able, but at the same time, you know, there's nothing wrong with speaking the way you do with your friends. It's like, you know, man dem and, you know, whatever else. Because, you know, they're young women of African heritage. There's certain terms and language that, you know, when they're on the streets, that's how people speak.
Yeah.
They identify, and you've got to be able to move and be flexible with it. So for me, flexibility is important in language.
Yeah.
But kind of understand, you need to understand where you are.
Yeah.
And what you're, it's almost like having a strategy. What are you trying to achieve?
Mm.
There's no point walking into certain spaces and saying, oh, yes, you know,
yeah, it's not believable either. As
no,
well, it's like, who are you? Who are you? And in terms of your identity,
be authentic.
But you are being authentic throughout, though. You were authentic when you first came with your accent. You were still authentic when you had a posh accent. It was still you, but it's also how people perceive that, and it's how do you find that kind of balance within all of that that you've been your journey.
And it's also to do with navigating a new society, because I was a new person. I didn't understand the difference in class. I mean, there was, you know, these things didn't exist for me in Trinidad, even race and stuff like that. And so I didn't realize that someone that looked like me was automatically believed to be to fit into a certain space. So I would just walk in and just, you know, be me. But over time, I realized and I felt more comfortable, and I don't want to be perceived in a certain way either. So, you know, I want to be able to relate to my people and my community.
Yeah.
And that's the other thing.
Yeah. I mean, in terms of the sound of music, the musical sound poetry, I find...
I like the film, by the way.
The film. Sound of music. I love that film. It's my favorite classic. Yeah. But in terms of that as well, like, you know, I've got my installation at the Coronet Theatre, which you have been kindly enough giving me your voice as well. And your voice is in this kind of soundscape where there's lots of different languages of poets from different countries. And it really brought to life the idea of musicality of words, whether you understand the meaning of them or not. Just the sound of words has its own existence separate from the meaning of them. Do you find that in your...
Oh, yes, definitely. Definitely.
Is it like composing like a sound piece just as much as it is a meaning piece?
Well, I'm a presenter on Portobello Radio.
Yeah.
And also I do my own show on a Saturday. And on my own show, it's a kind of much more Pan-African, you know, it's focused on African people of African heritage. And I play music from across the diaspora and the continent. So a lot of the music I play is in Portuguese, or it might be in French, it might be in Wolof, it might be in Zulu, it might be, and I still connect to all that music.
Yes.
I love language. I wish I could speak all the languages you do. I speak a tiny bit of French and a tiny bit of German, but, you know, for me, actually, one of the things I want to do is I want to learn Wolof, which is a language spoken in Senegal.
Amazing.
And I think, and it's actually quite a lot of Arabic in there.
Is there?
Yeah,
there's
that North influence. Arabic has influenced a lot of the languages or the culture in that area because of Islam.
Really?
So, it's, I would like to be able to learn that because the sound is so different to what I'm used to, speaking English and Western languages. Yeah. and I want to try and relearn some French. Yeah. So I think if I'm going to be in Senegal more, I need to be able to speak French.
Are you going to be there more?
Yes, yeah. Definitely.
So it brings me to my last really question, was about the future for you. Like, where do you see things evolving in terms of your words, your spoken word, and your work in general in the community? What is your trajectory?
Well, one of the things I'd like to do is a piece of work around the kind of reframing or the giving of voices to those who've had their voices taken away in relation to Kensington and Chelsea, because the whole thing has come up about Hans Sloane.
Yes.
And there's Hans Crescent and Hans Street and Sloane Square, and people are saying, well, there's this whole question about, do you pull down statues, do you rename streets? And I'm like, well, obviously if a statue of someone was, if this person was an ultimate, like an out and out fascist, then we have to have a conversation as to whether they should still be there. Yeah. But if this person was of a colonial era, is it necessary to take down a statue or rename a street? What does that achieve? Or is it better to make sure that the other side of the story is told?
Also told.
So somebody like Hans Sloane, for example, was an enslaver. He made his money and his wealth and his fortune through the enslavement of people in the Caribbean and Jamaica. But for me, it's like, well, actually, the way to balance that is perhaps to give a voice to hit the people who were enslaved, because they're responsible for his wealth, which in turn is responsible for much of the wealth, the unearned wealth in this country. So I would like to do a piece of work on that, trying to find and do some work about identifying people, the sorts of people, because we won't be able to tell exactly who they were, but the sorts of people who would have been enslaved and what their voices might have said and who they might have been. Because I think it's that's a more effective way than just renaming Hans Crescent. I mean, what do you get out of renaming Hans Crescent?
Yeah.
You know, it's better to actually mitigate the damage, repair the damage by finding the people who didn't have that voice.
Yes.
That's sort of something I'd like to do. And just, I think, like this whole thing that you're doing with Kensington Chelsea Art Week, taking a focus on the north of the borough, I think is really important that we have more of that. I'd like to see more, because for a long time, it's, you know, a lot of focus around art and culture has been in the south. And I feel that it's a part of the work that I'm involved in. I want to do, see more of the recognition of the culture and the identity in this part of the borough.
Yes, I love that. Mm. Wow, I'm looking forward to all of that.
Definitely.
Yeah, thank you for your work. That's so important. And
thank you.
And for being a part of this program with
us. Great.
Yeah, thank you.
So
how was that for you? Yeah,
fine.
It's a wrap.
Okay.
That was good. That was, that was very good.
Thank you.
Really good conversation.
That was nice. It was lovely.
Yeah.
You're a natural conversationist and presenter.
Oh,
interviewer.
Thank you.
She's really good, isn't she?